So a quick run through of the schedule. I'm giving a quick introduction. I'm Jeremy Cohen from Imperial College London. I have been organising this DiveRSE series together with an international team of people who've been helping to organise and promote the series. Following this brief introduction, we will hand over to Hana for her talk, and then we will have a Q&A and discussion. We'll have hopefully around 15 minutes or so for discussion after the talk. Just a quick bit of background on the DiveRSE series. So this series came about as a result of a workshop, Vive la Difference Research Software Engineers, which was held at the Lorentz Center in the Netherlands, just back in mid-April. And the workshop was, it was an invite-only workshop because it had a limited capacity. But of course, this is an area where I think there's huge interest, and it was clear that a lot of the topics that were covered at the workshop had very wide-ranging interest within the research software engineering community. So to try and take some of those topics and the discussions and the thoughts and ideas raised at that workshop to the wider community, we've set up this series. And over the last few months, we've been running talks around about monthly, which we hope to continue over the coming months. And really the aim has been just to bring some of these topics, as I say, and discussions into the wider community. And we hope that that this is something that people are interested in and are keen to engage with, and we will continue to run these sessions, as I say, over the coming months. I'd just like to highlight to you our code of conduct. I'm sure many of you are very familiar with these codes of conduct from events, workshops, talks, etc., that you've been to over recent months and years. But I do nonetheless encourage you to take a look and to familiarize yourself with our code of conduct. And I'd obviously like to highlight that this does apply to all of the communications and discussions that take part as part of this talk, and indeed all of the talks and activities related to the DiveRSE series. So with that, I will hand over to Hana, and we will hear about lessons from diversity, equity, and inclusion in open source software.
Okay, so why does diversity in open source software matter, and what can we do about it? This is a question I'll be discussing in my presentation today, lessons from diversity, equity, and inclusion in open source software. Hi, everyone. Thank you for joining. My name is Hana Frluckaj. I'm currently a PhD student at UT Austin and also a research associate at Carnegie Mellon University. Before I start, I want to go a little bit into the motivations of doing this work on open source software, why I think it's important, and my own personal reasons for it. So open source software represents an important form of digital infrastructure. Lots of really popular and successful projects have come out of it, including Linux, Mozilla, and Apache. Open source is also integral to research and scientific software development, as academics and researchers work together, build on each other's code to improve their respective scientific fields. Open source also provides an alternative career path for people who haven't had traditional education. So someone who didn't go to a university to study computer science can use open source as a means of learning how to code, honing their skills, and even using their profiles as resumes to get jobs. Open source is a collaborative learning environment where, in theory, anyone can contribute, anyone can use the code and distribute it and use it for their own needs. There are a lot of great projects out there. One that I wanted to highlight is this project in the bottom right, which is LGBTMD. This project, which is still in its early stages, and you're welcome to contribute it to it, of course, helps people who are LGBT plus find medical providers near them to get the healthcare that they need. And so there's a lot of great projects, and open source has the potential to empower a lot of different groups. However, this isn't really always the case. So there's always been a big diversity issue in open source. I think the gender diversity is one more well known, but just for some context, in the US, at the broader industry level, 30% of computer scientists and developers are women. And in open source software, that's about 5%. So quite disjoint from the rest of the industry. This for a couple of reasons. Open source does have some libertarian origins. So prioritizing free code and free speech and putting less emphasis and value on social issues. Open source was started by a lot of cisgender white men. And when I say cisgender, meaning people who identify with the gender assigned to them at birth. And as a result, there's always been this male majority, and we have pretty much no data on race or ethnicity either, because those contributors are too few and far between. We can see with the most recent GitHub Octoverse survey, so this was done in 2021, that open source is growing rapidly, with 16 million users joining this past year, bringing it to 73 million users overall. The survey shows that just 5% of respondents identified as women, 1.9% as non-binary, and 3.7 did not disclose this their gender, potentially from lack of gender inclusive options. At the same time of the survey, we see increased reporting for people who identify as LGBTQIA+, with 22% of US-based Gen Z identifying in that category. Also in the US, we see increasingly the minority becoming the majority, where, I mean, more and more people are identifying with some sort of minority or underrepresented group. This spells trouble for open source because it's becoming increasingly irreflective of the next generation of technologists and users. It's important for these projects to reflect, to be diverse and reflect their user base and developer base, as studies have shown that benefits of open source projects that are more diverse in terms of gender and race within these projects leads to more creativity, as people are coming from different perspectives and different lived experiences, helping create a more well-rounded project, and higher productivity in open source projects. Also, these projects are more innovative, with people coming in, challenging what's already been done and what's already known, and bringing in their perspectives to help reflect their own experiences and the experiences of others that identify with them. And so because open source is currently irreflective of the next generation of technologists and users, this is a serious issue that we should work on addressing. As far as my own personal motivations, I studied computer engineering at Carnegie Mellon. And while I was an undergrad, I joined Laura Dabish's lab, and I was brought in to interview women core contributors in open source. So while interviewing these women, I got a glimpse of what it meant to be a woman developer. So that included one of my interviewees breastfeeding while I was interviewing her, because you do what you gotta do. But also, because I was a student, I did get some warnings of how the industry could be and what working could be like. So hearing about sexual harassment at job interviews and sexual harassment and stalking at conferences. So all of this coupled with my own difficult experience as one of the few women computer engineers in my major, and also being first gen, I saw how difficult it was to be not only a woman engineer, but also difficult for marginalized contributors to get involved. So that brought me to where I am currently now. I'm currently doing a PhD at UT Austin on this work. And I'll be talking through a couple of projects. I'll be mostly discussing our research questions and results, and talking about the methods at a higher level, but I can go into more detail about the methods towards the end. So the first project that I want to get into is on codes of conduct in open source software. This is one that some people might be familiar with, and I've included the citation and link down below, and I also have a PDF on my website for easy viewing. I'd also like to start with a little bit of background on code of conduct history, specifically in open source software. So open source, just like a lot of different online communities, have these unspoken written rules called netiquette, which depending on what the community values and culture is, they have a certain agreed on behaviors that a newcomer, especially someone coming from a vulnerable group, doesn't know and can lead to some barriers upon entry. So coupled with open source's diversity problem, as I said before, open source has long prioritized free code, and associated with that is free speech, including free hate speech. So there's a philosophy in open source where people feel that they can be as critical and as negative as they'd like in the effort of making the project have the best quality that it can. And so as a result, this deters a lot of people coming from more diverse contributor groups. And in 2014, Coraline Atta MK, who is pictured here on the right, released the Contributors Covenant, which was the first code of conduct specifically for open source projects. This code of conduct was meant for open source moderation and governance. This came along because of those netiquette issues where people were getting verbally abused, but also in the years leading up to this, there were several events where women were being harassed at conferences and open source events. So Coraline released this document, and I actually had the honor of speaking to her last year, and she told me she still gets death threats to this day for releasing this because a lot of people were really angry. They thought it was infringing on their free speech. They took it as a personal affront and also as an affront to the ideals of open source. So, you know, thankfully to the risk that she made, there was a little bit of a rocky start, and there still is heated discussions about whether projects should include open source, should include codes of conduct. We're still seeing more projects adopting them. So overall, we see a positive trend there. As far as what were our research questions with the project, we wanted to know what were the public conversations people were having about codes of conduct. So how were projects and communities talking about codes of conduct? How are they talking about it when somebody wanted to adopt or create a code of conduct? Once adopted, what were the modifications made to it? And how is the code of conduct used to moderate behavior? So for the first question on the creation adoption, the vast majority of code of conduct additions got no response from the community. When there was some response, it tended to be supportive but minimal. I wanna go back to that for a second, but I also wanna discuss a couple of the discussions we saw. This was in the minority, but some people were arguing that the code of conduct wasn't useful because it's just a document, and what is a document going to do against someone who wants to submit hurtful comments. Another critique we saw was that people viewed codes of conduct as political statements that didn't have a place in the neutral world of software development. And we also saw some people championing codes of conduct as a welcoming message for new contributors. So we saw some discussions, but overall, there was very little going on. If there was something, maybe a thumbs up or one positive comment saying, go ahead. As a result of these minimal discussions, that led to a lot of latter miscommunication, misunderstandings, and community misalignment on what sort of behavior is okay, because they hadn't really discussed expectations and consequences and infringements. As far as modifications that were made, we classified the changes into content and non-content changes. So content referring to the actual meat or content of the code of conduct. A lot of the changes were for improving the availability of maintainers. So if you see on the right here, this was a group where they were getting people to have their names on the code of conduct license team to add some accountability. In case there was an infringement, now there was a list of people that you could turn to and hopefully get some conversation with. Another content change was making the project more approachable for beginners, helping with documentation and keeping the content updated as some maintainers left, came in as the community changed. As far as non-content changes, these were mostly for improving the visibility and reach of the code of conduct. So this usually came in the form of improving the formatting, improving accessibility, and even language translations. Now, as far as moderation, we saw codes of conduct used proactively as a reminder of community guidances, but the majority of the time they were used reactively to moderate unwelcome behaviors. So these unwelcome behaviors usually came in the form of some disgruntled contributor complaining about either the response time or a bug or some other grievance and exerting their frustration in a negative comment. You would see then the moderator, who is usually the owner or maintainer, say something along the lines of, hey, we're sorry to hear this, we'll be working on it, but just so you know, this sort of language isn't accepted, and you know, if you have more questions, here's the code of conduct. Then we would see the original infringement, the original infringer either apologize. So there were a fair amount of apologies and people, you know, seemingly sincere about, just stepping back, and also some people doubling down. So some people continue to berate the moderators. And as some of those issues got a little bit more lengthy, we would then start to see some community involvement. And that would contribute to more complexity because the community would start to chime in with their own comments, or even, you know, just with emojis. And in cases where the community was against the moderator, that's where we saw the most heated and intense debates. One thing I'd like to point out is there's a question I've heard as to whether maintainers and moderators should delete comments in cases where it's a bit spammy and you see some trolling. Yes, delete. But in the paper, we argue that you shouldn't delete the comments, assuming that you are noticing the infringement, saying it's not okay, and also working against it, so enforcing the code of conduct. And while you might have some negative comments, this contributes to social learning. So the community can come together, recognize what kind of behavior is unacceptable, so they know not to do it, you know, later. And also they know if they themselves experience this sort of comment, they'll feel safer because they know they have the community behind them, because this code of conduct is a community accepted document. So in general, don't delete those comments. And I'll go a little bit into some of these heated, lengthy debates. This was for SantaGate and TS Lint, if you haven't heard of them. There's a little bit more information about them in the paper, but this first one, SantaGate, is because of an event in 2019 where VS Code inserted a tiny, tiny little Santa hat on one of the icons. And as a result, this person who, if you look into it, is clearly trolling, but said something along the lines that VS Code was pushing their religion on them, and they felt it was as offensive as a swastika. So this quickly became inflated, and there was a huge community discussion. Microsoft ended up deleting a lot of the comments, but the Santa hat was removed, and people also lost some trust in the community as a result. So that was one example of a really heated debate. Another is TS Lint. So the maintainer of TS Lint put out this message that they didn't want their code used by Palantir. Palantir is a surveillance company in the US, which works with ICE, immigration services, to deport illegal immigrants. And this maintainer didn't want their work to be used by Palantir. And you can see there was, from this first issue, there was a lot of community discussion. And if you go to this thread, there's quite a lot of fascinating stuff going on. But anyway, things got quickly out of hand, lots of really negative comments. And this points to a community that is not well aligned as to what are its values. And for a newcomer stumbling on this kind of project, if you see those things, you're not really likely to contribute. And so this goes into what it's like to join as someone who's coming from a vulnerable group. So this next project is the one that I was originally brought on to interview women at Carnegie Mellon. So this was on the gender and participation trajectories of men and women in open source. This hasn't been published yet. It's been accepted, coming out in fall, but I've included a preprint on my website if anybody wants to read it. So as I mentioned, I was brought on to interview the women. Another interviewer who was also male interviewed 10 men. I interviewed 11 women, three of whom were trans. And our research questions with this project were, compared to men, why do women initially engage in open source projects? And compared to men, how do they increase their involvement over time? And additionally, what are the unique experiences that women face at each stage in a open source project? So for the first two questions, initially we saw a lot of people, both men and women, getting involved because the open source work was somehow relevant to their job, to their daily work, and it made sense for them to use this project in their daily work. As far as an interesting thing we saw with women, a lot of women became more involved because some intrinsic motivation related to their interests. So some of them wanted to learn a new language and felt that contributing to open source in that language would help them hone them skills. some also wanted to play around with a hobby or just in general, get a little bit more involved. As far as how they increase their involvement over time, both men and women, as they got more involved in the project, would adjust the forms of work that they did to relate to the project needs. But another interesting thing that we saw were building relationships. This was really important at the initial stage. So a significant amount of women in our sample were invited into a project. This is important because one, that invitation indicates, hey, we think you're great, we recognize your work, and we'd like you to come work with us. So these women felt got some recognition for their work. And also the person sending that invitation was a point of contact in the project. I wouldn't go so far as to say mentor it would depend on a case-to-case basis, but at least someone that they knew within the project, someone that they could ask questions to, get over any initial hurdles with. So that was really important initially. And that continued with women as they increased their involvement. So building relationships helped women get more involved in the project. That included with the other developers on the team, as well as working with the users. So a lot of women would serve project users by responding to their requests, talking to them to gather some feedback, and also organizing community events, doing documentation, those sort of things. Some unique challenges that women had, I'll get into, but I'd like to start off with something that we've all probably experienced, which is imposter syndrome. So a lot of us as academics and scientists have experienced imposter syndrome, where we're not really confident in our abilities. And just for some context, if you're the only woman in a project, just joined a new group, there's a lot of men around you, that imposter syndrome is elevated with these visibility pressures. So it's a little bit more difficult for women and really anyone coming from an underrepresented group to feel comfortable initially. And so that's what we saw with a lot of our participants. These visibility pressures took a couple of different forms. So our first participant said, if I had something like name, which was their feminine name, it would identify me right off the bat as a girl and I'd get more respect if I don't do that. So this person ended up using an alias. I believe it was the initial of their first name because they didn't want to be outed as a woman in the project. Another example, what came from a maintainer who the maintainer and the co-maintainer were both trans, and they were aware that as the project got more popular and the project got more attention, they became more visible. And they were almost expecting to get some online hate, online verbal abuse. So while they're doing something that they really love, they are sort of preemptively defensive about how their progress and how their changes could reflect badly on them and cause them some pain. And again, coupled with imposter syndrome being one of the only women in the project, there was a lot of sense of looking stupid or people not wanting to ask questions because they thought that would make them look dumb, feeling as if they weren't good enough, just sort of taking a back, not being as active because of their role as one of the few women in the project. And so as far as the continued participation challenges, so the excessive scrutiny and the visibility challenges developed to where as their tenure matured on the project, they would start to see some differences in how they were treated versus how the average man was treated on the project. So this came up in the first quote where this participant said, if anyone else in the organization opened a PR, it would get a looks good to me, maybe to one or two comments, and then it'd go in. With my PRs, there'd be 50 to 100 comments nitpicking and nitpicking on things that didn't matter and telling me how to rewrite the code. So this person clearly had a different experience from the average man in the group and also experienced some condescension. Gender non-inclusivity was an issue where this second participant said that a developer who she was working with whenever he referred to people who really knew what they were doing, had been in the company for a long time, he would refer to them as graybeards, which I personally hadn't heard of before. But yeah, this participant didn't find that particularly inclusive because it implied that people who knew what they were doing could only be men. And another unique thing that we saw for women was maternity leave. We saw women's three of our participants went on maternity leave at some point, and as a result, their contributions drastically decreased for 3 to 6 months. There was actually an interesting case where one participant had been working overtime in the sense responding to user requests later in the night. I believe she was on the East Coast and would get requests after 5 p.m. East Coast time because of the time difference. And the company hadn't known that she was doing this work. So when she went on maternity leave, they realized as these requests were coming in and piling up that she had been doing all this work, that she hadn't been compensated for it. And so as a result of this, they ended up changing the company rules and distributed the work a little bit more fairly. And yeah, so there was a lot of very unique experiences that women had, and especially the trans women that I spoke to. There was definitely a sense that their perceived gender or how other people in the project would perceive them was a little bit more of a concern for them. And that led me to do some follow-up interviews with genderqueer perspectives. I'm using genderqueer here as a sort of umbrella term to refer to anyone who doesn't identify with the gender they were assigned at birth. So that ended up with me doing 21 interviews with trans, non-binary, and genderqueer open source contributors. My questions were, what were the unique experiences that genderqueer contributors face in open source software? Are they more prone to attacks or early dropout rates because of their identities? And also, how do they manage their online identities? So for the first question, as far as unique experiences, there was a lot around their transition. Obviously, a lot changes with your transition. And I think this participant three, this is a great example where before they had come out, you know, they were working on open source, and before they'd come out to themselves, they were sort of just passing time in open source, and they didn't really feel that impassioned by it, but it's what they had always done. And then after coming out, their interests had sharply changed, and now they didn't want to associate with their previous projects, and instead they decided to contribute to smaller projects and almost mentor younger contributors. As far as our second question on attacks, we saw a lot of different examples of hidden microaggressions. So a microaggression is something that seems harmless, usually in the form of some sort of comment, or maybe you're treated a little bit differently. And it seems harmless, but is considered by someone belonging to an oppressed group to be harmful because it shows some bigoted attitudes and assumptions. Yeah, we saw a couple of examples of hidden microaggressions where it was really interesting that a lot of different participants said, I'm not sure if this was a microaggression or if it was just an accident, if it was just circumstantial and, you know, maybe it was just something off that day. But I believe like half of the participants mentioned, I'm not really sure if this was a microaggression, but this weird thing happened. And so this was one example where one of my participants had created a package manager, advertised it in a server and got zero response. But then someone the next day also advertised their own package manager, and that person got more interactions, and that person was a cis male. And so things like that made it difficult to know if they were being treated differently or not. But when several different participants say the same thing, it makes it seem like maybe this is, there is a common trend. There are also cases of transphobia and homophobia. In one particular case, there was a quite large open source project that had its own moderation team. And a user joined the team, I believe it was a friend of the maintainer. And this user said some homophobic and transphobic things. The moderation team attempted to enforce it, but they sort of their ruling was that the they needed the maintainer to do say something or to agree on the enforcement, and the maintainer refused to do anything, so implicitly accepting that sort of language. And so after, I believe, the third time that person said something transphobic, the entire moderation team resigned and the project fractured. And so split into two, which obviously affected that community. Another interesting thing that we saw because of these attacks, because of genderqueer identities, is a certain amount of internet research, let's say. I'm sure we've all done some Facebook stalking where we've looked up people that we're working with, or, you know, someone that you're curious about. But things take a little bit more of a serious route with genderqueer contributors. There were several examples of people saying, you know, I'm really interested in this project, but before I start contributing, I'm going to look into the issues. I'm going to look into the people involved, look at their, if they have some blogs, if they have a Twitter profile, look at what they're saying. If they're saying something homophobic, transphobic, fascist, etc., I know this is not a safe place for me and I'm not going to contribute to this project. So people's online activities were had a great impact on whether or not these people chose to contribute to the project. And also the inclusion of a code of conduct was a big signal for genderqueer contributors of whether or not they'd be feel welcomed or not. As far as online identities, imagined audience had a huge impact on how people presented themselves on GitHub and other social media sites. So participant one created a GitHub organization to redirect their dead name profile to their new name. So I was informed recently that GitHub has since changed this. So now you can change your name without jumping through a lot of hoops. But at the time, a lot of genderqueer contributors had to either delete their profile, lose a lot of valuable work, transition to a new one, create this GitHub organization. And even though GitHub has fixed it, there's a lot of social media sites who haven't yet. Many participants came out to their online friends first. So this was people that they felt they could trust, had known for a while in Discord and private servers. And people would also update Twitter to identify their identity more publicly, but they wouldn't do so for Facebook or LinkedIn, for example, because they felt that those communities better reflected their ideals. And yeah, they would stay away from 4chan. They're wary of Reddit. And just to go back to the difficulty with transitioning, there's also a lot of academics who, when they transition, they have a hard time getting their citations fixed. So there's a lot of infrastructure that makes it difficult for genderqueer contributors to, and genderqueer academics, scientists, to have their work accurately reflect their identities. So yeah, diversity, equity, and inclusion is integral to the future and success of open source software for a couple of reasons. As we mentioned before, diversity in projects fosters creativity and innovation. As these projects come in with people with more, with different lived experiences, different perspectives, helping them create technologies that better reflect the modern population. We need more diverse representation so that underrepresented contributors can bring in their worldviews and perspectives, challenge what we take for granted. A lot of the theories that we're building off were created by predominantly cis white men, and a lot of other perspectives weren't taken into account. So with this increased representation, we can help create better technologies, better theories, and so on that better represent our changing world. Now, what have I learned and what can we do? So invitations, mentorship, and allyship are all really important. As we saw with the women in open source projects, invitations give an indicator that this person's work is valued, that they're already included in the community, that they want, that they're wanted, and they have a point of contact. Mentorship is on a more long-term basis, so guiding this person through whatever process it is in open source, the contribution process, getting more involved with different forms of work in the project. And yeah, while people generally tend to respond better with in-group invitations and mentorship, so someone from your own underrepresented group, kind of like a role model. While people benefit from those, people benefit from those interactions a little bit more, allyship is still important. So allyship, you know, sends a clear signal that you're valued, that I'm here to help, and helps boost self-efficacy and self-confidence in these vulnerable groups. And again, all of these factors work for helping build social connections, enabling that person to succeed in their careers. Using inclusive language and signals, as we saw, you know, before, people from vulnerable groups are doing research to know if they're going to be valued, if their own values align with the maintainer or with the group that they want to join. And so being aware of what you're, how you're representing yourself, and if you're showing support for various issues, can make a real difference. Centering and protecting underrepresented voices and perspectives. So in your own communities, just having an outlet for people to voice their opinions, to listen to them, and also if there's a risk for their heightened visibility, to if they might get more attacked, if they might get attacked, what are the protections involved? How are you going to support these underrepresented participants? Valuing invisible and alternative forms of work is also really important. So in open source software, a lot of work done by women is documentation, supporting users, community involvement, and that work is undervalued. One, because it's done by women, and two, because it's not technical contributions, but it's just as important for project health and project sustainability. In academia, we tend to focus more on citations, number of papers published, and don't seem to value open source projects and code created and maintained as well. And so that's another thing that as a community, we need to reevaluate how we consider these things for tenure, for new jobs, et cetera. Open communication. So as I mentioned before, not deleting those comments when they come up, and actually enforcing the code of conduct, having open discussions before you create a code of conduct. So understanding what are the boundaries for your community, what are the consequences, and having very open discussions about these things. And finally, diversity, equity, and inclusion work is a learning process. We all make mistakes and we're all learning together. I think the key is to just keep an open mind, listen to other perspectives, and work to make your environment inclusive for everyone. Before I go, I just wanted to direct everyone's attention to the recent Supreme Court ruling in the US, effectively removing a person's right to an abortion, a fundamental health issue in many states, including Texas. I wanted to give a shout out to this fund in particular, the Lilith Fund, which aims to help fund abortion access in Texas for reproductive equity. Thank you, and also special thanks to Miranda Munt for helping me with these slides. And questions?